In this lecture, we are going to study how context switching happens in XV6. Please refer to this URL for more details on this complete series of lectures on operating systems. So before we understand context switching, it is important to know how processes and schedulers exist in XV6. So in XV6, every CPU has a separate process-like thing called the scheduler thread. So this is like a special process. I mean, it's not a user process. It doesn't have any user level code or anything, but it is like a process for all practical purposes. It is called the scheduler thread, right? So every CPU has its own scheduler thread whose job is to find processes to run on this particular CPU. And of course, this scheduler goes over this P table. We have seen that XV6 maintains an array of all processes in the system called the P table. It has an entry for every process. So the scheduler goes over this list of processes and it finds a runnable process and switches to it, right? Of course, if this P table entry is not valid, it's not used, or if the process is sleeping, or some such thing, you won't switch to it. You find a runnable entry and switch to it. And after running for some time, this process will then switch back into the scheduler thread for whatever reason. Suppose if either of the process has terminated or the process has made a blocking operation, a blocking read system call, needs to sleep, or it yields if it has run for too long. For whatever reason, the process will once again switch back into the scheduler thread. And then the scheduler will once again loop over the P table, find some other process to run. And after some time, the process will once again come back to the scheduler. In this way, the scheduler constantly keeps sharing the CPU across multiple processes in the system. In the very first lecture, we've seen that the OS gives the impression of virtualization of the CPU to the processes. That is, it gives the impression that each process has the entire CPU to itself. That happens in this manner by frequently switching between multiple processes. Okay, so this is a context switch, switching from the scheduler thread to a process and from the process back to the scheduler, from the scheduler back to another process. This is the context switching that we want to understand in this lecture. Note that this context switching only happens when a process is already in the kernel mode. A process in user mode cannot say, I want to context switch to somebody else, right? Suppose a process P1 is running user code, then it has to jump into kernel mode, right? It has to jump to its kernel stack, start executing on its kernel stack, and then it has to switch to the scheduler thread, and then the scheduler thread will switch to some other process, and that process will then go back into user mode. So if you want to switch from the user mode of process P1 to the user mode of process P2, you have to go to P1 has to go into kernel mode, has to switch to the scheduler thread, the scheduler has to switch into the kernel mode of another process, and that process has to return to user mode, right? So this context switching only happens in the kernel mode. A user space process cannot simply say, I want to jump to another user space process. So now the scheduler switches to a user space process in the scheduler function. So there are two important functions that control this context switching. This scheduler function is run by the scheduler thread. Okay, it's a little confusing, but there is a scheduler thread whose job is to run the scheduler function. And this scheduler function loops over all the processes in the process table one by one, finds a process that is runnable and gets it running. Okay, it will switch to that process. So this is the important line here. It will switch to that process that it has found to be runnable. And a process, once it runs for some time and it wants to give up the CPU, it will call this function sched. This function, what does it do? It will simply switch back into the scheduler again. Right? So what is the switch statement? We'll study in a little bit. But for now, just understand the high level structure of the code. Right? The scheduler function will switch to some process. And that process, after it has run enough, it will call the sched function. And that sched function will once again come back into the scheduler loop. And this will keep going on. Okay, so who all calls the sked function? A process calls the sked function for three reasons. We've seen this before. If a timer interrupt occurs and a process feels like it has run for a long time and it wants to yield the CPU, then it calls the sked function. So this yield is called whenever a timer interrupt occurs, and within yield, you set your state to runnable. You're no longer running, you're just ready to run. Runnable is ready to run, and you call the scheduler. Or if a process has terminated, so this is a snippet of code from the exit function. A process will set itself to zombie and give up the CPU. Or if a process has to sleep for whatever reason, it is waiting on some event and it has to sleep, it has to block. Even in under that conditions, it will set its state to sleeping and it will go ahead and call the scheduler function. These are the three ways in which the sked function can be invoked by a process. And the sked function will context switch back into the scheduler. And then the scheduler will find some other process to run. So now, as part of this context switching, there is an important data structure called the struct context, right? This is what is saved and restored during a context switch. Okay, so this function switch that we saw, which actually does this context switching, we are going to study it in some detail in a little bit. What it does is it switches between two contexts. It saves the struct context of the old process and restores the struct context of the new process, right? So that is why it is called context switching. So what is the struct context? It's basically a bunch of registers, right? It is some CPU state that you are saving. Why only these registers? I'll explain in a little bit. But you basically, when you are moving away from one process to some other process, you have to save some registers. For example, you have to save the EIP of where this process P1, suppose you're shifting from process P1 to process P2. You have to remember where you are stopping process P1, at what EIP you are pausing, so that at some other point in the future, when you come back to P1, you can resume from the same point, right? So that is why you have to save some context. And all of this context, the struct context, is pushed onto the kernel stack of a process. And the kernel stack and the struct proc, the PCB, maintains a pointer to this context. Okay, so this has to be saved and restored during a context switch. So on the kernel stack, this context, the structure is pushed, and from the PCB, you maintain a pointer to this, right? So now, in a previous lecture, we've seen that whenever there is a trap, you save the trap frame. Right. This is also the trap frame also has some register state that is stored on the kernel stack, and that is also pushed onto the kernel stack. And now this is also a different data structure that's pushed onto the kernel stack. So what is the difference? Okay. So the trap frame is saved when the CPU switches to kernel mode. Whenever there is a trap, that is when you save the trap frame. Right. So in the trap frame, the EIP value is pointing to whatever was the EIP value when a system call was made. It is pointing to some user code, for example, right? So that is the EIP value. That is the CPU context of whatever execution was happening before the trap. That CPU context is stored in the trap frame. On the other hand, the context structure saves the context just before the switch statement. Just when you are about to switch, the EIP value that is there, that is what is saved in the context structure. Note that these are two different things. For example, if a process has made a system call, then the EIP value in the trap frame will point to some user code that was running just before the system call happened. And in the context structure, the EIP value is pointing to the switch statement, right? Whatever statement, whatever is the EIP value when the switch is invoked, that is what the EIP value is pointing to. These are two different things. These are two different contexts saved at two different points of time. All this context, anything that is saved on the kernel stack, but they are two separate structures. Okay, and the struct proc of a process has obviously as pointers to both. For example, let's consider this example, right? A process P1, it has a timer interrupt. Then what happens on its kernel stack? You will first push the trap frame, right? And the struct proc, this trap frame pointer, will point to that. It points to the context saved when a trap happens. And later on, after timer interrupt, this process calls yield and it does a context switch away to some other process. At that point, another more context is saved on the kernel stack. And that is the context structure. And a pointer to that is stored in the, also stored on the kernel stack. And a pointer to that is there in the struct proc. Right? So the struct proc has two different context pointers. One is a pointer to the trap frame and one is a pointer to the context structure. And this context is what is saved and restored during context switch. And this trap frame is what is saved and restored during the trap handling. So I hope the difference between both these is clear. And they also save slightly, though there are a lot of common registers that are saved in both these events, there are also some slight differences in what is actually saved, what context is saved for both these events. Okay, so now we've set up all the context needed to understand the context switching. We've seen what is the data structure that is saved, where is it saved on the kernel stack, how a pointer to that is maintained in the struct proc, all of that is clear. So now let us actually study the switch function, the function that actually switches the context. Okay, so the switch function is invoked both by the CPU thread and by a process. Okay, so each of these has their own struct context, a pointer to the struct context. In the case of the process, it is maintained in the struct proc. For the CPU thread, there is a per CPU data structure that keeps a pointer to the struct context. So both these things have their own struct context. And switch takes two arguments. It takes the old context and the new context both as arguments. It will save the old context and it will switch to the new context. Okay. So the one subtlety is that there is a pointer to the context and the address of that pointer. So the first argument to switch is an address and the second argument is simply the context pointer. Okay. So there is the context saved somewhere. And there is a context pointer somewhere, a variable that is pointing to this context. And the address of that variable, that is the first argument to the switch function. Okay, so this is a double pointer. And the second argument is simply the pointer to the context. Similarly, so when switching from the scheduler thread to the process thread, the first argument to switch is the address of the pointer to the scheduler's context. And the second argument is simply the pointer to the process context. When switching from the process to the scheduler, the first argument is the address of the pointer maintained in struct proc. And the second argument is simply the scheduler context pointer. Okay. So the first argument is address of old context pointer. So address of a pointer. And the second argument is simply the new context pointer, right? The argument two is simply, there is a new context. Argument two is simply a pointer to the new context, right? So why is this complication? You'll understand in a little bit. Just bear with me for a while. So now let's look at, let's understand what the switch function does, right? So this is a function call, right? So as part of the C calling convention that we studied a few lectures back, what happens when you make a function call? Before this function call is made, already on the stack, which is the kernel stack here, you have already saved a few things. You have already saved the caller save registers. And you have saved the EIP, which is the return address. All of this has already been saved on the kernel stack of the old process, right? So this is the old process's kernel stack. This has already been saved just when switch is invoked. Who has saved this? The C compiler generated code would have saved this as part of the C calling conventions. Now you come to the switch code. What will the switch code do? Already some registers are saved, the caller save registers. So it will push the remaining registers onto the kernel stack of the old process, right? It will push the callee save registers. You only need to push the callee save registers. Why? Because as part of the function call, the rest of the registers have been pushed. So you push the remaining registers onto the old kernel stack, whatever you're switching away from, right? Understand what these terms old and new mean. The old stack is if you're switching from scheduler to process P1, the old stack is the scheduler stack. The new stack is the process stack. If you're switching from the process to the scheduler, the old stack is the process stack. The new stack is the scheduler stack. Okay. Whatever you're switching away from on that kernel stack, you first save the callee save registers. And now your complete context is there in the stack, right? So this top of the stack contains your context that you have saved. So save a pointer to this from your struct proc or wherever, right? You keep a pointer to, you save this pointer saying now all context has been saved. Then what do? You are also given the new processes kernel stack. Now your ESP, your stack pointer, which was pointing to your old stack, you pushed all of these things, your ESP is pointing here. That ESP now switches to the new kernel stack that you've been given, right? So this is a context switch. The switch from one process kernel stack to the other, that is the moment when your context switch happens. So now your ESP moves from the old kernel stack to the new kernel stack, to the new context structure on the new kernel stack, right? So what will you find on this new kernel stack? You will find the same thing. This will also have the same format. It will have the callee save registers. It will have the EIP. It will have all these things. Why? Because this process was also context switched out in the past in the same function. Therefore, the exact same thing, whatever your old stack looks like, that is what your new stack will also look like. Okay, so you save the old context, ESP, you switch to the new stack, switch ESP from old kernel stack to the new kernel stack. Now your ESP points to, you have the exact same stuff that you just saved on the new stack. So then you do the same things. You pop, you return from the function call to wherever this switch function returns to, right? So the important thing to note is on the new stack was exactly the old stack at some other point of time. You know, some process P1, you switch to another process P2. And from P2, when you switch back again to P1, the stack of P1 will be the exact thing that you had saved in the past. Okay. So therefore, on the new stack, you will once again find the callee save registers, the EIP, the caller save, everything. You pop them, you return back from the function, and you resume in the new process. So as a result of the switch, you switch kernel stacks, and earlier you were executing in the code of one process. Now you resume your execution. Your EIP is pointing to the new process code. You resume your execution in the new process. Right? So that is what the switch function does. It switches from the context of one process to the context of another process. Note that these two are just, one of them is always the scheduler thread in our case, right? So now is the really hard part where we try to read the assembly code of the switch function. I've just described to you what happens as part of the switch function. Now we are actually going to read this code. If you're not very familiar with reading assembly code, you may want to skip this part because the logic of what happens in the switch function has already been explained. But if you are curious, you can go ahead and bear with me through this explanation. Right? So now this is the actual code, right? Let us bravely go through it. So this is the switch function, right? Your scheduler, sched, both these functions call switch with two arguments, okay? So by the time the switch function call is made and you've reached here, you're as part of the C calling convention, you have already pushed a few things. You've pushed the EIP return address and the arguments onto the stack. They have already been pushed. And recall that arguments are pushed in the reverse order. Therefore, your kernel stack, as you read from top to bottom, will have these things. It will have the EIP. It will have the address of the old kernel stack, and it will have a pointer to the new kernel stack. All of these arguments are already there on your kernel stack when you have called this switch function. Okay. So now what the switch function does, first thing is the first argument at an off, and this is your ESP. Your ESP is pointing here, right? So at an offset of 4 from ESP is your old kernel stack address. That is saved into EAX. And at an offset of 8 from your ESP is the new kernel stack pointer that is saved into EDX, right? You read the arguments into EAX and EDX. Why? Because these arguments are already there on at the top of your stack as part of the function call. So you read them into EAX and EDX. Okay. So just to understand, what does EAX and EDX have, right? Let us make this very clear. So there is the old process, right? The old process has a context structure. There is a variable, say struct proc, and the address of this variable, that is what is stored in EAX. Okay. And then you have the new context somewhere. So this old process context is pointing to something, right? And this new process context is also pointing to something. And that address directly of that pointer is there in EDX. Right? This is what is there in EAX and EDX. So let me draw this a little bit more clearly so that it becomes clear for you. And this is a subtle concept, so I'd like to take my time to explain this. So you have the struct proc of the old process has a context pointer, right? And this context pointer is pointing to some context. And the address of this variable is what is there in EAX. So EAX is pointing to this context pointer variable, and that context pointer variable has some address that is pointing to some context. And the new process, this is the old process. And the new process has its context stored somewhere. As part of its struct proc, there is a context pointer that is pointing to this new context. And your EDX register is simply given that value of this context pointer. So your EDX register is also directly pointing to this new context. It also has the address of that new context, right? So here you have a double pointer. Here you just have a single pointer. So now your EAX and EDX are set up this way. Now next, what do? Now you are on the old kernel stack, right? So there is your old kernel stack. On this old kernel stack, you pushed the caller save registers, the EIP, then you push the callee save registers, right? You start building up your context on your old kernel stack. Now, after this is done, you push the callee save registers onto the kernel stack of the old process. EIP and caller save are already present, and you push the callee save registers, right? EIP, caller save, all of these are already present. Now, the top of the stack here, right? The top of the stack, this value of the top of the stack, this has the context structure. So what will you do? This ESP value, you will save into the address that is there in EAX. The address that is there in EAX is this old context pointer. Now this value, you will write into this variable. You will go to the address that EAX is pointing to, and this value will be rewritten to point to this. So now this old context pointer was pointing to some stale thing, right? The previous context which something it was pointing to. But now the context pointer that's say there in the struct proc that is updated to point to the old to this latest context that you have saved, right? That is why there is a double pointer here, right? It is not enough to write this value into EAX. You have to go to the address in EAX, whichever is the original variable that EAX is pointing to. And in that, you update this pointer. Okay, so you move the current value that's there in ESP, the top of the stack, right? So ESP is pointing here. This value you write into whatever is the address that is there in EX. And now, whatever is the value is that is there in EDX, your ESP will end up pointing to that. So here you have basically switched to the new stack, right? So the top of the stack, wherever you stored the old context, that has been saved. And then you switch stacks. Now you know the pointer to the new context that is already there in EDX. You simply read that value into ESP. Okay, now the CPU now is on the stack of the new process. ESP is pointing to the stack of the new process. Now what do? After the switch, you simply pop all the callee save registers. You return, the return will pop the EIP, the caller save registers and everything. And your context switch is complete. Right? So I will once again go over this code because it is somewhat confusing, and let me summarize it. So there is your old stack that came with caller save registers, that came with EIP. On top of it, you save the callee save registers and the ESP value. This latest ESP value, you go write it into whatever EAX was pointing to, right? Your EAX is pointing to your field, the context pointer field. You go update that context pointer field to point to this value, right? So your old context pointer into that field, you write this address so that it points to the updated context of the old process. And then your ESP will shift to, there is this new context. I mean, the context of the new process, which again has the callee save, EIP, the same structure it has, which is there in EDX, right? EDX is pointing to this new context. And then your ESP will simply switch to that. You copy, move the value of EDX into ESP here. So this is the context switch. You move that into ESP. So now your ESP is pointing to the new stack. So this is the old process and this is the new process, right? And you switch to the new process here and you pop the callee save registers and you return. When you return, you pop the EIP, you pop the caller save registers, and you are back to wherever this process that you're switching to gave up its CPU in the past, you are back there. So in essence, the call to switch basically freezes a process, right? A process is executing some code, then you call switch, you pause here. And later on, when you're switched in again, you will return and you will continue. Okay, that is how context switching works. So this is a summary of context switching in XV6. So let us just take an example, right? You want to switch from process P1 to P2. So P1 goes into kernel mode, saves the trap frame, and it decides to give up the CPU, right? Some timer interrupt or due to exit or sleep or whatever, right? And P2 is another process that is ready to run. So now this process gave up its CPU in the past for some reason, but now it is ready to run. Maybe the event that caused it to sleep that it was waiting for has happened. So now it is ready to run. So what happens? P1 switches to the scheduler thread and the scheduler thread then finds the runnable process, say P2, and switches to it again. And then P2 will return to user mode, okay? So this is the sequence of events during a context switch. And the actual process of switching from P1 to the scheduler thread or scheduler thread to P2 involves a call to this special function switch, which basically saves all the register state on the kernel stack of the old process. All the state, the context is saved on the kernel stack of the old process, right? So the context is saved on the kernel stack of the old process. Then the stack switches to the kernel stack of the new process, where it will find the saved context that it had saved in the past. It will restore all of that. And the switch function causes you to jump from executing one process to resuming in another process. So this is the most involved, intricate part of XP6. Please go back, read the code once again to understand it better until you are fully confident that you understand this process fully.